Now, I read Song of Songs many times since I became a Christian. I became a Christian in 1978. I can't tell you how many times I had read Song of Songs. But up until about 7 months ago, I had never really wrestled in earnest with it. It's one of those books I'd read, and I'd read, and I'd read, and I just always felt like I wasn't getting it, that there was something I'm not understanding. But, you know, you have to pick where you spend your time and what you can do, and I'd never devoted myself to it. So about 7 months ago, I said, okay, I'm going to actually wrestle with this and see what I think the message of this book is. And so that's what I'm going to be sharing with you. And what I want to do this evening really is to introduce the book. We may get beyond that, but I want to at least introduce the book. And as I always say, introductory material, it's not filler. I mean, a lot of times when you talk about introduction stuff, you say, well, that's not, you know, I don't have to worry about that. That's not true. Because what the introduction does, it will explain to you my perspective of the book. And see, then that'll allow you to use that, see, to evaluate my teaching over there. If you come in and you don't hear, like for instance, when I'm teaching the epistles of John, if you don't understand what I think is going on and the context and setting of that, and then you hear me talking about it, you'd be going, why does the guy keep talking about that? Because it's the setting of the letter. And so the introductory material, it sets my perspective so you can then say, okay, I see what he's saying. You can gauge whether or not you think that perspective is accurate. And then you can also, from that platform, evaluate the teaching. So don't tune it out, because if you do, you're going to miss much of what I think I have to offer. And I'm pretty excited when the opportunity came up, because I think this is the age group that I think you can't get too much younger, because the Song of Songs is sexual. And so you don't want to get down too low. And you want to get young people who are right in this age group. So when this opportunity came up, I said, yeah, I'd like to teach Song of Songs because I think I have something to teach on it. Now, if you're interested, and in case you don't already know, my notes for the class, they're available at my website. It's theoutlet.us. And you could go there and you could see all the notes. And they follow the outline. The notes are in the outline that I'll be presenting. And you can have access to them there. And also, you can see the annotated translation that I'll be, when I'm going through, there's a translation I have prepared. It's annotated in the sense that it puts in the speakers, so you know who's talking. And that makes it much easier for you to figure out what's going on. So that'll be up there, and you have access to that. Now, George Schwab, he's an Old Testament scholar, and his opening statement in his 2008 commentary, it's the Expositor's Bible commentary, it's the revised edition of that. But his opening statement in his 2008 commentary on the Song of Songs, it well expresses the difficulty in understanding this book. And if you've read it and wrestled with it, this will resonate with you. He says, when a newcomer reads the Song of Songs, he or she is confronted with a jumble of images that seem to run together and suddenly shift with no rhyme or reason. One may ask, when does one section end and another begin? Is there a story being told? And if so, who are the characters? And what is the plot? Without an answer to those questions, the book is confusing and enigmatic. To many, the Song of Songs remains a closed book. And I think that's absolutely true. In the church, we hardly ever talk about the Song of Songs or use it in any way. And part of it is because it seems so like, what in the world's going on? So I'm hoping after this class, you'll see something that I hope will be useful to you. They can discover little practical value in its 8 chapters. The book does not speak of God, the law, or the history of Israel. Paul claims that all scripture is profitable for reproof, correction, and training in righteousness. But how can this be true of the Song of Songs? And that's really the question. What is the message of the Song of Songs? Why is it in the canon? What's its function? How does it work and what is its message? Now, the book's been understood in many different ways throughout history by both Jewish and Christian interpreters. Indeed, the famous 19th century theologian and Hebraist, an expert in Hebrew, a guy named Franz Delitzsch, he called it the most obscure book in the Old Testament. And you have people saying that about different books, but that ought to tell you something. It's no easy sledding, but whether you agree with that assessment or not, interpreting the book clearly calls for a large dose of humility and recognition that other approaches may be correct. See, when you come to any book that people have wrestled with for thousands of years, some of the greatest minds on the planet, and they come up and they have different ideas, when you approach it, then you just do the best you can and you work diligently and say, okay, this is what I think. But you understand your perspective might be off. Okay, so you have to approach it that way, and that's what I try to do, is to share with you how I understand things, and then I want you to see if you think I have tracked the spirit. In other words, have I captured the spirit's intention? And to the extent you're convicted that I have, well then you'll be influenced and moved by the Word of God. Now my own understanding has been greatly influenced by a commentary that was published last year by an Old Testament scholar named Ian Duguid. He's published many commentaries, Ezekiel, and I can't remember all the others. But his was a replacement volume in the Tyndale commentary on the Old Testament. Now, he and I part company on some details, but his overall approach and his view of the structure of the book, it was immensely helpful to me. And when I got my hands on that book and I started reading it, and I go through and I'm going, oh, whoa. See, so for me, it was like a gold mine. So I have farmed that bad boy, and I will be sharing the fruit of that with you. Now, rather than explore all the various alternatives, you could do that. I could teach and I could say, okay, here, now another way of looking at this would be this. You could look at it this way. You could do the structure this way. I'm not going to do that. What I'm going to do, I'm going to present to you my take on the book. I'll just explain to you how I understand it, like I say, and then I'll leave it to you to judge how closely I've captured the Spirit's intention. And so you'll then have to do that. Now the book, it's known by several different English titles. Maybe you've noticed that. You pick up different Bibles, you see different titles of it. And here's the literal rendering of the first verse, Song of Songs, which is understood, it's not in the text, which is to Solomon. Now, some of the titles in English Bibles, they will be Song of Songs. That's how it'll be titled in the table of contents. Well, Song of Songs, well, that takes, obviously, the first clause, which are the first two Hebrew words, Song of Songs, and you take that, and so it's titled that way. Another title of it, you'll see, is Song of Solomon. Now, Song of Solomon, that takes the name from the, that emphasizes the second clause. And what it's focusing on is Solomon's relationship with the work. But as I'm going to explain in a minute, to the extent that title conveys the notion that Solomon is the author of the book, I think it's misleading. Now that may strike you. You may all your life have thought that Song of Solomon's written by Solomon. So when I say that, you may be going, ah. Right? I think that's misleading. I don't think Solomon's the author. I'm going to explain why I don't think that. But right now I'm showing this is, it'll be titled Song of Songs, Song of Solomon, and then you may have seen this, Canticle of Canticles, or simply Canticles for short. Now that name comes from the way Song of Songs was rendered in an old Latin version called Vulgate. Okay, you had this phrase here, it was translated Canticum Canticorum, which simply comes into English then as Canticle, song or hymn, and the plural is canticles. So those are the three titles you typically see of the Song of Songs, and if you're wondering why does it have different titles, well, there you have it. That's what, so the title isn't that important, except to the extent Song of Solomon says to you that Solomon is the author, I'm going to take issue with that in a bit. Now the opening verse, you see that it informs the reader that it's a song, right? It's lyric poetry. That's important because it's that rather than some other genre of writing, some other kind of writing, like proverbs or historical narrative. And that's very important. It has to be read then and interpreted as poetry. You see, when God inspires somebody to write in a certain form or genre, that genre has to be taken into account when you're trying to grasp what is God saying. Because if he didn't want to say it in poetic form, he wouldn't have done it in poetic form. So you have to take that into account. In that regard, Duguid in his commentary, He quotes C.S. Lewis's remarks about Psalms, which is, of course, another collection of songs. And Lewis says about Psalms, he says, what must be said is that the Psalms are poems, and poems intended to be sung, not doctrinal treatises, nor even sermons. Most emphatically, the Psalms must be read as poems, as lyrics, with all the licenses and all the formalities, the hyperboles, the emotional rather than logical connections, which are proper to lyric poetry. They must be read as poems if they are to be understood, no less than French must be read as French or English as English. Otherwise, we shall miss what is in them and think we see what is not. And that's very important. And so when you see some of the images and these shifts and things, some of these dream states that we'll get to, you say, well, that seems, why would somebody write? Because it's a poem. You see, it's lyric poetry. I wanted to try to bring out the impact on genre, on how you understand something. And I was thinking of the statement, if you just saw the statement, his heart was taken. All right, just that statement. And you can see how you would be inclined to read that differently in different kinds of literature. Okay, so for example, if it was a love poem and you read his heart was taken, you'd be inclined to think it meant he was smitten. Right? The guy's heart was taken. I mean, his love interest has captured his heart. Now, if it was a news report, you might think, well, an organ for a transplant patient had been stolen. So they're telling you this story, yeah, down on the street, his heart was taken. We had a gang, they were running organs, and they took this guy's heart. If it's an autopsy report, well, you're thinking it was surgically removed for study. If it's a horror novel, it was hacked out as a killer's trophy. And if it's an interview with an athlete, his heart was taken in that his will to win was sapped. Okay, so you can see, right? I mean, this is the kind of literature you're reading influences how you read it, or at least it needs to if we're going to hear it correctly. So that's the first thing I want you to recognize. Now, the author of Song of Songs traditionally was thought to be King Solomon, based largely on a particular understanding of verse 1. Now, the second clause of that verse, it literally reads, which is, and there's this Hebrew preposition, le Solomon. It's really, it's a prefix, so it's lishlomo is how it reads. But the preposition is le, that's what you need to get. So, which is that little preposition, Solomon. Now, the preposition, it has a wide range of meanings. And though it could mean that the book was by Solomon in the sense that Solomon was the author of it, that's certainly a legitimate understanding of how that preposition functions, but other meanings are possible, and in this case, I would say probable. Now, when I say something like that, if your translation says by Solomon, you're saying, what's this guy doing? Is he trying to pull a fast one on me? So let me give you some quotes to reassure you that when I tell you that that preposition need not mean that he wrote the book, you'll have some confidence that I'm not blowing smoke. Okay? New English Translation has a lot of notes in it. Here is the note from the New English Translation. It says the preposition, lamed, it doesn't have the vowel there, in Asher Lishlomo has been taken as authorship, which is written by Solomon. The lamed of authorship, also known as lamed auctoris, is well attested in Hebrew, particularly in the Psalms, and gives some. 2, dedication, which is dedicated for Solomon. The lamed of dedication is attested in Ugaritic Psalms, dedicated to Baal or about Baal. Or 3, topic, which is about, concerning Solomon. The lamed of topic is attested in Hebrew and in Ugaritic. So that's the notes from the New English Translation. Old Testament scholar Tremper Longman, in his commentary on the Song of Songs and the New International Commentary on the Old Testament, in that series, he says the preposition lay that is prefixed to Solomon's name can theoretically be understood in more than one way in this context. To Solomon, the book is dedicated to Solomon. By Solomon, authorship. Concerning Solomon, Solomon is the subject matter of the book. Solomonic, which may mean something like in the Solomonic wisdom literary tradition. Now, I know at least one scholar who challenges the last one, but that's Longman's understanding and Longman's take that even that one is a legitimate understanding of the preposition. Dwayne Garrett's an Old Testament scholar, and his commentary on Song of Songs in the Word Biblical series, he says, Lishlomo may be rendered of Solomon in the sense of belonging to Solomon's collection. It could also be taken as Lamed Octoris, meaning written by Solomon. It could possibly mean to Solomon in the sense of dedicated to Solomon or written for Solomon. Finally, it could mean concerning, after the analogy of concerning Moab. So you have that. Now we have here Robert Jensen interpretation, that series, his commentary on Song of Songs. He says, then there is the clause which is Solomon's. This is not necessarily an ascription of authorship by Solomon. It could also be rendered dedicated to Solomon, or about Solomon, or in Solomon's style, or perhaps in yet other ways. So you see that. Then we have Ian Duguid. He says the remaining words in the title, which is Solomon's, are ambiguous. They could mean that this song was written by Solomon. However, the preposition Lamed has a wide variety of uses. Lishlomo may mean belonging to Solomon or pertaining to Solomon in a more general sense. And so that's what I'm going to suggest to you is going on. There are a number of reasons to doubt that Solomon is the author here, that verse 1 was intended to convey Solomonic authorship. In other words, reason to doubt that we should read that preposition as saying by Solomon in the sense that he was the author of it. When Lamed, when that preposition is used in titles of Psalms to denote authorship, there are places in Psalms where it's used that way. And it's pretty clear on a number of them, including authorship by Solomon. You see that in Psalm 72:1 and 127:1. Well, even there, when it happens, there is a grammatical difference, because the relative pronoun, which, that's used in Psalm chapter 1, verse 1, is never used in those contexts where it's clearly used, when the preposition is clearly referencing authorship. So you say, okay, well, that's something, you know, that you have these clear examples. You can say, well, see, there it is right there. You say, well, even there, it's different grammatically, because here we have the use of which, this relative pronoun. Secondly, Solomon's referred to throughout the Song of Songs in the third person. Now that seems odd, doesn't it, if he's the author of it, that he refers to himself in the third person? He does that in 1:1, 1:5, 3:7, 3:9, 3:11, 8:11, 8:12. Always speaking of Solomon. So that says to me he's not the guy writing it. He's somebody remarking on Solomon or talking about Solomon. So that's not what we would expect. And he seems to be viewed from a distance. Now this takes some argument, and I can't do it right now. But as we walk through it, when we get to chapter 3, 7 to 11, and chapter 8, verses 10 to 12, Solomon seems to be viewed from a distance there, and his harem and his approach to the institution of marriage, they're compared negatively to the love relationship that runs through the song. Now, I'm going to have to explain that and you know, basically argue that for you and let you see if you think that that's right. But when I get there, that's the case I'm going to be making and saying, listen, it's not only that you have him referred to in the third person, he is distanced, and he actually functions as a foil, as a contrast in the background back there. See, his well-known excesses, they serve as a foil to help bring the joy and the blessing of the starring couple's relationship into full relief. See, he's the contrasting background that really pulls out the joy and blessing of the starring couple's role. That's really how he functions there. It's unlikely that Solomon would present such a subtle critique of his choices. Sometimes people say, well, Solomon, you know, maybe he changed and this. But if he did change, if he repented, if he said, listen, I took the wrong path with regard to marriage, I wouldn't expect him to make the criticism that so subtle. You see, if he was really somebody, I'd expect him to be more forthright and say, this is what I did. I wouldn't expect it to be this kind of foil or this contrast thing. And if he hadn't repented, I wouldn't expect him to suggest his guilt or his wrong in any form. So that doesn't really strike me as very sound. Now, as somebody engaged in political marriages, this guy, he had hundreds of wives and concubines. as somebody like that, his life is completely at odds. Completely at odds with the portrait of the loving couple that you see in Song of Songs. There's simply nothing in his life to suggest that he knew or he appreciated the kind of relationship that is the focus of this poem. I mean, you know the text. 1 Kings 11, 1-3. Now, King Solomon loved many foreign women. Now, the way I understand this, by the way, is there's a dash. It's basically a parenthetical. Loved many foreign women from the nations concerning which, in addition to those foreign women, he also, along with them, he loved foreign women, the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, and Hittite women. But the bottom line is he has a lot of wives. A lot of women, says, concerning which the Lord has said to the people of Israel, you shall not enter into marriage with them, neither shall they with you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clung to these in love. He had 700 wives, princesses. These are political marriages. He has married daughters of rulers to fortify relationships between his nation and theirs. So he has 700 wives and 300 concubines, which are really lesser wives. Like second, stepwise, I'm trying to think of second class wives. But he's got 700 wives, 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. Now, as you'll see, if you don't know already, as we go through here, this is nothing like what you see portrayed in Song of Songs. And part of the reason of the confusion, I think, is once we start thinking Solomon is the one who wrote it, or Solomon stars in it, well, it's hard to correlate what you're reading with this. It's like, well, how can that be? How can this intimacy and this exclusivity and all of this that we long for, how can that be something this guy's involved in? Well, I think that's because we've gotten off on the wrong track in thinking that Solomon is the person who actually wrote it or even that he stars it. Now, as I see the Song of Songs, it's an anonymous poem or song, lyric poetry. It's an anonymous poem that speaks of the power and the delight of young sexual attraction. And it extols the blessedness of that attraction culminating and being satisfied in marital exclusivity. So that's what I think is going on here. This delight of young sexual attraction, and it lifts up the blessedness of that attraction culminating and being satisfied in marital exclusivity. See, it's about sexual love that finds fulfillment in marriage. And it makes the point that marriage enhances rather than diminishes the relationship. Now, you understand this is ideally, but this is God's vision. And so it makes the point that, contrary to what the world says, the idea that, well, now, you know, we've this sexual excitement that we had, this young sexual love and attraction that comes together in marriage and is fulfilled there, well, now it's a bummer. You see, that's not how it's to be. And it makes that point, and I hope you can see that when we go through it. So I take verse 1 of the poem. I take it to mean that the poem relates to or is directed to Solomon, probably posthumously, as Israel's most famous representative, I would say notorious representative, of one who took a contrary marital path. He took a contrary marital path, one who rejected or missed God's ideal for the expression of human sexuality. See, the song speaks to all of mankind, to the extent that we in our sinfulness, to one degree or another, we miss or reject that ideal of God. And so it uses Solomon's notorious rejection of the goal as a foil to draw out into contrast. But it relates to all of us to one degree or another, to the extent that we don't capture that. Here's Abdug with his remarks. He says, in fact, the Song of Songs is best understood as a wisdom piece about two idealized people, a man and a woman whose exclusive and committed love is deep, but like all loves in this fallen world, far from perfect. You'll see insecurities that are reflected. He says their idealized love story is contrasted with the alternative Solomonic model of love, quote, that we see in 1 Kings 11 that I just read to you, a model that views marriage primarily as a commercial and political transaction, a means to wealth, security, or political advancement. It seems more plausible overall, given Solomon's negative role in what follows, that the author is anonymous and he intends to contrast the true, wholehearted, lifelong devotion of the couple that he describes with Solomon's notoriously different perspective on love. I think that's right. You see, now from that perspective now, to me, the book opens up. You see, it just opens up and now it teaches things, and why I'm glad to have an opportunity to teach young people. Because as I say, it's about this excitement of young sexual attraction that finds its fulfillment in that marital exclusivity. You're the people to hear this. You see, it's not people who've been married 50 years, 60 years. I don't know, in this church, man, I'm 70, Danny. I don't know. We used to. You still have 70. Now, behind all of this and magnifying the significance of the poem is the larger truth that the marriage relationship has from the beginning been a metaphor for God's relationship with his people and Christ's relationship with the church. You see, for example, in the Old Testament, Jeremiah 2:2, go and proclaim in the hearing of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, I remember the devotion of your youth. Your love is a bride. Well, see, the marriage relationship functions as a metaphor for mankind's relationship with God, and here Israel's. So he says here, your love is a bride, how you followed me in the wilderness in a land not sown. Jeremiah 3:20, surely as a treacherous wife leaves her husband, so have you been treacherous to me, O house of Israel, declares the Lord. So you see, it is from the beginning, it has functioned that way as a metaphor. And of course, in the New Testament, you see Ephesians 5, 25 to 33, we could have gone up a couple verses, but it says, husbands, love the wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, cleansing her by the washing of the water with the word, that he might present the church to himself as glorious without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but in order that she might be holy and blameless. I always say when I read this thing about a husband's responsibility to his wife, this has nothing to do with Song of Songs, well, maybe indirectly, but this is just a footnote. Husbands, Christian wives ought to say to the world, everybody wants a Christian husband. We ought to be those kind of people so that your wife would say, you have to be crazy to get anybody as a husband who is not a Christian. Because our lives are tied up in dying for our wives. Okay, so these are the caricature that our world puts out about Christian husbands being brutes and just wanting to boss their wives around. This is just a lie. Do people do that? I understand we're in a fallen world. People are sinful. I get it. But don't tell me that is what God calls us to be. Okay, that commercial's over. All right. In the same way, the husbands also ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. No one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes as Christ also does the church, for we are members of his body. Now for this reason, a man will leave father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This mystery is great, but I'm speaking with reference to Christ and to the church. A man will leave father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This mystery is great. But I'm speaking of the reference to Christ and the church. It has from the foundation been a metaphor for God's relationship with his people and Christ's relationship with his church. And in case you also, one by one, let each love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she fears, she respects the husband. So this is a thing, you see, this is, so behind this, you have that. So the joy, the depth, the excitement, the intimacy, the fulfillment, and the exclusivity of the marital relationship as poetically idealized in Song of Songs speaks to the relationship that God intends for us to have with Him. You see, so first you have this beautiful story about, well, what is the ideal for sexual expression where you have a man and a woman who are in love and committed, and you have this excitement of sexual pull and attraction that finds culmination and fulfillment in marital exclusivity. That's a message. But then that behind that functions at a secondary level, because that is a metaphor of the relationship we're to have with God. All right, so that's part of what is at work here. Now, as I indicate, I don't believe Solomon's one of the main characters. He's not the author in my judgment, and I'm not alone in that. And I don't think he's one of the main characters in Song of Songs, that he's one of the lovers. Indeed, Solomon, either as a prince or a king, there would have never been a time when he'd be out there with flocks in a field, as you see in chapter 1, verse 7. Rather, the two characters, the stars of the poem, they are fictional characters. Fictional characters who are created by the poet as vehicles to express God's ideal for the expression of human sexuality and to speak indirectly to our relationship with God. You see, so it's a poem where these characters are portrayed in this idealized sense because it is giving to us God's perspective on the fulfillment of human sexuality in this relationship, and then that indirect testimony about our relationship with Him. As Dugwood says, he says, the focus of the song is not on the specific identity of the lovers so much as it is on the nature of their love. Ah, you see, that's right. The nature of their love. You want to see this idea of this excitement and how powerful it is, and the pull and the waiting and the longing and being torn up about it, and then together. And that, see, that, okay. And so that's the thing. It's about the nature of their love. Then you contrast this with somebody who looks at marriage like a business. You know, I need to marry her. Why? Well, I need a good relationship with this guy so he can ship me some stuff. I mean, that's like, dare I say, crazy? But this raises a question now. How do we understand the references to the king? You see the king mentioned in chapter 1, verse 4, and in chapter 1, verse 12. How do we understand the various references to Solomon that I mentioned before, where you see, you know, there are these, I said that he's referred to in the third person, and I rattled off the different texts where that's true. Well, how do we understand those? I'm going to give you my thinking on that while we work through the text. Okay, when we go through the text, we'll get there, and I'll tell you how I see that. And then you see if, well, I think, okay, yeah, that makes sense. Or you say, all right, I think I'll stuff that over here, and I'll keep listening to see if he's got anything worth saying. Okay, but that's how I do it. But I'll try that. Now, when is it written? Since I think that the Song of Songs, I think it's an anonymous work that was directed to Solomon only as a kind of tragic counterexample. You see, it involves him only in that way. It could have been written any time after Solomon's view and his treatment of marriage was known. Well, Solomon dies in 931 or 930 B.C., I'm sure his treatment was known, if I'm right that it's written posthumously, because I don't think anybody would risk doing that. So, say from 930, but we also know that we have a translation of it by the middle of the 3rd century B.C., so let's say 250, so sometime in that window. It doesn't really matter, but that's about how much you can narrow it down. And moreover, the songs, they could even be a collection of independent love songs. You see, that have been put together by an inspired editor. You know, God inspires and moves people in different ways. So if He's at work in these different songs, and then He's at work in the editor, who then puts them together, and so then they could have been written at different times. All the Word of God, all exactly what God intended to be written, but the process by which God inspires and produces these things is more complicated than we often think. In other words, it's not always like just God dictating to somebody. If that were the case, you wouldn't see the the differences in writing styles and this kind of thing. He leaves room for, when I say the human aspect, you can be misunderstood. But he leaves room for individual variation in how he's inspiring people. You see, like he trains Paul and has Paul trained so that Paul will write in a certain way. And you say, well, how could anybody do that? Well, nobody could. God could. You see, it's that great of a thing. Now, the structure. There's much disagreement about the structure of the Song of Songs. But here's an outline that I'm going to be following. It's modified slightly, Dugwood's outline. If you just pass those around. See, I think this way. I think in outlines. And when I find an outline, it helps me greatly to see things. So that's what I'll be following as we go through. So I'll present the blocks of text that way, and then you can see, and we'll go through and I'll talk about them. Now, the translation that I'm going to be using is one that I prepared. You say, well, who are you? I'm certainly not a Hebrew scholar, but I have a lot of tools available to me. I have many commentaries on the Hebrew text, and I had Dugwood's translation, but I have many translations. So in using, here are the English versions that I consulted in preparing the translation. Now, why do I do this? I do it because it saves me time, because I can let you see in the translation how I understand what's being said. When I get on anything that I think may be controversial, I will then go ahead and I'll explain and say, okay, this is why I rendered it this way. Because this guy Fox, who's an all-world Old Testament scholar, he says this and this and this. Okay, so I'll back up anything like that. But mainly they're just things that I put together. See, as I read and I look and I read these different, these are the main commentators. I looked at other commentators. But these were the main ones that I used. And like I said, they're commentators who comment on the Hebrew text. So when they get there, they will talk about these different Hebrew grammar and all these things. And I just happen to have a nice library. And so I have these things. And so it takes me a while. I have to grunt through it. But it's just easier for me to teach that way. And so that's why I'm doing it. I also periodically looked at standard Hebrew lexicons and theological dictionaries. Like when I was trying to decide between a phrasing or something, I would go and look at the, you know, and see what do these people think, what do these people think, and I'd make my best call on it. There's nothing radical in it, okay? You know, you're rightly nervous, but you can follow along with whatever translation you prefer, and you'll see. Now, like I said, when there are things that are, I think are unusual or something might catch your attention, I'll elaborate on that. All right, the text. We've got about 10 minutes, and we'll start. Song of Songs, chapter 1, verse 1. Song of Songs. The way I did it was that relates to Solomon. I've already pitched you on that, why I did it that way. Now the phrase, when you look at Song of Songs, I mean, that could simply mean the work is a single song that is made up of a bunch of songs. Right? It is a song of a multitude of songs. One song made out of a bunch of songs. I mean, that would be a possible meaning. But most scholars understand that, I think, rightly as a superlative title. In other words, they understand that the way we understand King of Kings or Holy of Holies, you know, that means like, look, he's the greatest of kings. It's the holiest of places. So this means that it's understood to be, it's the best or it's the greatest of songs. So I think that's the right way to see that. Now that need not mean that the writer is asserting that it's the best or the greatest of all songs of whatever kind. It need not mean that. It could simply mean that it's the best or the greatest of all songs relating to Solomon. That's possible. See, that it transcends all of those songs that, and I don't know how many songs it would be about Solomon. I mean, Solomon was quite the poet, the psalmist and all this kind of thing. You know, he had wisdom and proverbs and all this kind of thing. So, it need not mean, you know, it need not mean this thing about that it's the best or the greatest of all songs. It could just be that it's the greatest of songs relating to Solomon. And in that regard, it transcends him because it so beautifully paints this picture, you see, of God's ideal for the expression of human sexuality against the contrasting background of Solomon's rejection of that ideal. So it could be, well, it's the greatest that relate to Solomon. Because here it's this beautiful portrait of what God intends, relates to Solomon, and that he's the foil for it that brings out so strongly. But if it does mean that it's the best or greatest song absolutely, I mean, I can't say it doesn't mean that. If that is the intention then, well, that assertion most likely is tied to that larger truth that the marital relationship is a metaphor for God's relationship with his people. See, if it's going to be the greatest song absolutely, I think you're going to have to tie it to that much larger purpose, to that metaphor, that transcendent thing, as the greatest portrait of God's ideal for the expression of human sexuality. It's the greatest song ever because that ideal points to the most significant relationship of all, that of God with his people. So maybe that's what it's after. But in any event, you take it Song of Songs, the greatest of songs that relates to Solomon, and then in chapter 1, verse 2 to 4, and you see here this is annotated. You see the woman speaks, the daughters of Jerusalem, you can see they come up in verse 5, that's who's speaking here, and then the woman again. And there are clues in here. Now there's some, at different parts, there's some disagreement about who's speaking when. And I'm following Duguid because it made a great deal of sense to me. Okay, but here we have the woman, and she says, "Oh, that he would kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. For your caresses are more delightful than wine. As for fragrance, your oils are delightful. Your name is poured out oil. No wonder the eligible young women love you. Take me away with you. Let us hurry. May the king bring me into his bedroom chambers." The daughters of Jerusalem, these maidens, these young women of marriageable age, they say, "We will exult and rejoice in you. We will praise or celebrate your caresses more than wine." Then the woman says, "Rightly do they love you." Now here the poet launches immediately into his subject matter. Jumps right into it by painting a vivid picture of the depth and the power of sexual love. This young woman is longing for the passionate kisses of the man she loves and for the sensual delight that she anticipates their lovemaking will be. You see, this, the word that's translated, Duguid uses and some other people, translated "for your caresses are more delightful than wine." That word, it's commonly translated love. Like, I don't know what you're translating, but very oftentimes it's translated love. See, in love, the connotation of love is a mental state. But see, what that misses from the word, the plural form of this word, it misses the sense of sexual touching that is evident in the other occurrences of the plural form in the Old Testament. Let me give you examples. Proverbs 7, 17 and 18. Here we have the immoral woman who's trying to lure this man. Her husband's on a trip. She's trying to get him in bed with her. And she says, "I have perfumed my bed with myrrh, aloes, and cinnamon. Come, let us take our fill of love." There's the word, plural.
First
time. He says, "Come, let us take our fill of love till morning." Now, is there any doubt what's being said there? Okay. "Let us delight ourselves with love, for my husband is not at home. He's gone on a long journey." Okay, I don't know if you know how this is in Proverbs, but it's warning the young man. I won't launch off on Proverbs, but young men, you listen, because this is powerful stuff. And so he's warning this, his son, you watch that. You see here in Ezekiel 16:8, this is God speaking. "When I passed by you again and saw you, behold, you were at the age for love." Dodim, the plural again. "And I spread the corner of my garment over you and covered your nakedness." He's speaking about Jerusalem or Israel. He says, "Over you and covered your nakedness. I made my vow to you and entered into a covenant with you, declares the Lord God, and you became mine." Ezekiel 23:17, "And the Babylonians came to her into the bed of love, and they defiled her with their whoring lust." All right, do you see the sense of it? It's more than simply the mental state. It deals with sensual, sexual touching. And so that's what he says. And after she was defiled by them, she turned from them in disgust. See, so that's why, in fact, the word, that word that is translated caresses in the in how I've rendered it, how Duguid and others render it, it's translated in the New English translation and in the New Jerusalem Bible, it's translated as lovemaking. Just flat out comes out and removes any ambiguity about it. It's also footnoted that way in the Christian Standard Bible, that this may be lovemaking. Okay? The girl is filled with sexual desire. That's what this is. She's filled with sexual desire, and the aroma of the man's cologne, aromatic oils, it's a delight to her. It's delightful to her senses. And he's thought of so highly that his name is a pleasing aroma to all those who hear it. See, speaking about him is like spreading perfume. You know, when you go and talk about somebody, people go, you talk about this guy, everybody's, oh man, oh, that's great. He's well received, it's like that. He's that kind of person, he's a man of substance and character. So her love for him is not merely physical. It's physical, but it's not merely physical. You see, this guy is a person of substance and character. She's crazy about him as a complete person. And he's such an amazing catch that all the eligible young women, see, those who've come of age to marriage, they naturally love him, or so it seems through her eyes. They'd be crazy not to. They naturally love him. They'd be foolish if they didn't. And the intensity of her desire for the man she loves, it's expressed in her longing to be carried away quickly to his bedroom. You see, she's aching for the fulfillment of sexual attraction, which in the context of Scripture and in the context of Judaism can be done morally only in a marriage relationship. This is what she's longing for. Okay, as we'll see, as Duguid says, the centerpiece of the book is a wedding scene that concludes with the consummation of their relationship. So this is what she's thinking about. She's eager to have this sexual excitement brought to fulfillment in their wedding. All right, so that's, I think, important. In that section right there, six times the man refers to the woman as my bride. Let me read what Tom Gledhill says. I think this is important. He says, in order to anchor the song securely in the social context of ancient Israel, it makes sense to assume that the lovers are a betrothed couple. It was sometimes the case that the man and woman had never met before their betrothal, and thus the relationship started from cold, as it were. But romantic love could also blossom, even in the more restricted social intercourse of Israelite society, see later on 8:5. So it's not inappropriate to view the song as the joyous, tentative explorations of love of the betrothed couple culminating in their marriage and full sexual union in 5:1. See, this is what I think is going on. It is an expression of the power of sexual attraction. And you'll see her struggle with this and the man as they are on their way to being married. But, you know, that pull doesn't stop. That pull does. So it's there and she's longing for this. And then we'll follow this story through and the intensity and their devotion and all of this. And it really paints a neat picture. And I hope I can convey that. Thanks for coming.